So good afternoon from my side as well. I'm Anonymized Litke. I'm going to be the presenter of this research work. Today we are here with two colleagues of this teamwork. It's George Fragos and George Paleokrassas. And we come from the National Technical University of Athens. And let's say what we are going to present today is our ongoing research about anonymous personalization for distributed applications over blockchain. To start with, I don't know if some of you had the chance to attend the main conference hall 1 hour ago, where our colleague Manuel Machado from the Blumen Project had a short overview of this, let's say, effort. The Blumen Project, a European-funded project under the Horizon 2020 program, is actually a project that tries to bring new solutions in the media industry. We know that the media content production and distribution is a very big market, and having some challenges, like for instance how it goes with compensations for content contributors, how it goes with the intermediation in the whole value chain, and how it goes with the royalty payments. And there is a big discussion today on how blockchains can actually contribute into disrupting this industry in multiple ways. Like, for instance, there is a big discussion. There are scientific reports, market research reports from many big outlets, consulting firms, saying that blockchains can be an enabling technology and can disrupt the media industry in multiple ways. And for all participants in the stakeholders in this value chain, like for instance, it can provide benefits for the content creators, fast frictional payments, increased revenues, direct communication to the audience, at the same time for the whole media industry and for the distribution channels, when they have the chance to provide new services, new disruptive business models, and bring, let's say, less cost and administrative overheads. And at the same time for the content consumers, direct interactions with the content creators, with the artists, and in such a way to have also a less cost when they have to, when they like to buy content and let's say interact with them. We have three use cases. The music use case on how can blockchains help to better connect artists and fans, how, for instance, blockchains can be the enabling technology for managing copyrights of the media content. News media content, it's the second use case, which has to do, for instance, on what they mention as participatory journalism, on how people as content creators can participate in this whole value chain. And Web TV, which is another use case powered by Antenna Cyprus, and how, for instance, you can have a whole use case being offered through blockchain as a Web TV content. What we know about blockchains and anonymity, as you all know, it's a public ledger, so actually you don't have you're not anonymized, you are pseudonymized. But research work, even from the late 2014, has shown that, for instance, these anonymous things that you might want to put on the blockchain can be revealed somehow and can be associated with your IP address. Today, we have also permission blockchains. Okay, but does it solve the problem? Not necessarily, because permission blockchains, as you all know, is actually another way of having not a totally decentralized approach, but rather also have intermediates. So anonymity is not solved at the same time. So when we say about anonymous personalization for the media industry, what do we talk about? The general idea is actually to introduce blockchain-based services as an enhancing, as for enhancing the quality of experience for the users. Actually, be able at the same time to increase privacy. This is why you have to provide the anonymization, but at the same time give a personalized service, because otherwise, you know that today we are very familiar with this thing. When you get into YouTube, the what they call the information bubble, the things that you see at first are more tailored to your personalized profile. So how you can combine this all together? A lot of research work, related work, like for instance, coin mixing. You can see that there have been many attempts in the past, recent attempts with using a ring signature somehow to try to mix the different transactions and actually provide a high level of anonymization for the different users that participate in these transactions. Dataset trading, another effort that has been introduced by Kiyomoto and Toll, where actually end users can share anonymously their datasets through some intermediates, privacy policy manager, as they call them, the PPM. And without going into many details, let's see also how our approach, how our research effort in NTUA is being implemented. So we are using, let's say, in this approach, a distributed identity management framework with blockchain, where the user real identity is stored in a distributed way through an IPFS file system, the interplanetary file system, which is a global peer-to-peer distributed file system fully compatible with blockchain, which at the same time returns two hashes, the access hash and the hash ID. So there, as you can see, the access hash is used to retrieve the user real identity from this IPFS distributed storage, and the hash ID, which is the user's unique identification key through which the specific user is being, let's say, recognized in the whole blockchain framework. Okay, but where it comes now about personalization and having at the same time anonymity. Since every user logs in the whole blockchain system, and we're going to see a little bit more in detail here what is this blockchain system we refer to. Since the user logs in with the hash ID, this is the unique way through which he is identified. So we have anonymity because the personal profile data that the user provides are being stored as set in a distributed database outside the blockchain. Because all we know that once written in a blockchain, it cannot be removed, or at least yet, because there might be some research effort that in the future, as we have a consensus into writing something on the blockchain, we might have a consensus into deleting something from the blockchain. So we achieve user anonymity, and now when it comes to service personalization, okay, just to give this as an example, as we said, by default, only the hash ID is the unique reference to the user on the blockchain. Other personal data that the user would like to provide, like for instance, name, email, phone number, VAT number, you name it, if you want to provide a professional service, especially in the media industry, then this is stored somewhere else, but the IPFS file system will give you, let's say, an access hash, which then, through this, you will be able to define where you would like to disclose your data. And just to give you an example, you see there the overall architecture where the user, in this case the user is, let's say, the content consumer. For simplicity reasons, we have tried to narrow down the size of this overall architecture, which is, of course, even more complicated. The user has a specific set of services, like, for instance, browsing the content, viewing the content, buy the content through crypto coins. Okay, so he has the wallet, he can see the balance, he can manage the wallet transactions, and at the same time, the data that he or she have provided on the system, besides, let's say, the generic data or even privacy-sensitive data, he or she is able to decide which of them are going to be visible whenever it is going to be a transaction on the blockchain. And there, for instance, you can see that, to give an example, by purchasing a specific content, they would like to say, okay, I would like also now to give information about my age or, for instance, gender information so that I can have a very tailored content the next time. We've heard also today, this morning, about the people saying that, okay, YouTube asks you not to filter out any content. Why? Because, I mean, all this information that you have stored in the cookies sometimes, of course, can reveal some things about your identity, but sometimes it makes it easier for you to see content that you would like to see when visiting a specific media content delivery platform. And so, through this, let's say, generic approach, we have managed to achieve both, let's say, anonymization, as every information is out of the blockchain, every personal information, sensitive information is out of the blockchain, and at the same time to provide different hashes about giving rights to specific media outlets to deliver content to you in such a way that is tailored to your personal profile. The whole implementation has been taking place over Hyperledger. We have deployed the three basic frameworks, the Fabric, the Composer, and the Explorer. Fabric is, let's say, the main framework, the first framework of Hyperledger, which actually is responsible for the transaction handling, for the functions related to the distributed ledger, the network peers, and all this kind of stuff, while the Composer provides a higher level API, application programming interface, that enables, let's say, a higher level of ready-to-execute scripts that are suitable, in our case, for the specific domain model. And last but not least, the Explorer, which gives the whole visualization framework, where, for instance, someone, an administrator, can actually see the different transactions that have taken place and thus have a clear overview of managing the blockchain transaction set by itself. Without, because I see also that the time is passing, without going into many technical details, as said, the specific architecture is, let's say, has been inspired, for instance, for the web TV use case, as said, that is implemented in collaboration with Antenna Cyprus, but it has been modular enough in order to allow other media-related applications and at the same time to be extensible through this business logic that has been implemented. And why Hyperledger in this case? Because you might have heard about many, many different frameworks which say that they might be more suitable for one use case or the other. It's a permission blockchain, so actually it's not a public one. So it works within a consortium. Somehow it cannot be regarded as a totally open, decentralized public ledger, but at the same time it allows you to make a first exploitation of the different dynamics of blockchains while you are still in an environment that you can control much easier. So for us, we are researchers, so for us it's very, we're familiar on experimenting with specific frameworks that we would like to explore the further dynamics. It has, let's say, consensus mechanism which can be regarded as an inexpensive one, meaning like, for instance, what they call the practical Byzantine fault tolerance or other related so-called federated consensus mechanisms which are totally inexpensive, not like proof of work. And it has a simple REST application programming interface that allows us to experiment also with other web-based applications so that we can provide a totally tailored application service for the media industry. So, as very brief conclusions, we can say that anonymized personalization, of course, is a very big topic. What I have presented today is mainly to show our initial approach into providing a specific framework for the media industry related use cases. And it has to do on how you can identify, how you can manage the identity, and how you can provide anonymization and personalization services to the users over blockchains. There are a lot of current research efforts towards this direction, so there are things happening there. So I'm sure that during next years we are going to be able to show even more things. And the permission blockchains are there as well to help and facilitate different aspects, different research priorities that someone would like to have when dealing with these things. A lot of things are going to be, I mean, by our team, are going to be handled during the next years, like, for instance, how to extend to other media use cases as well, how, for instance, we can engineer different things to work also in other solutions like Quorum, Ethereum-based blockchain so that we gain another momentum over the public blockchains, and of course on how you can navigate in this, let's say, overall content and personalization services through a recommendation system that can give you some additional, let's say, personalization capabilities. Here are some references of our work and the acknowledgement of the project that is supporting, that is funding our research. Thank you very much.
Since we have passed the time, let's have one question.
And actually, I've got three questions. but it's going to be like straight to the point.
It's going to be one.
First, why permissionless blockchain like Hyperledger, and why not go straight forward to the public blockchains to do their project? Second, does is it one blockchain across the consortium, or each each company has their own blockchain and they're linked together? And the third, how are you going to deal it internally with the 51% across between organizations? Because one big organization can actually attack the smallest one.
Can you please repeat the?
Yeah, the last one is how you're dealing with the 51% on the Hyperledger inside, which a huge corporation with more data can actually attack the smaller organization and say, okay, I can accept your data or not in the blockchain within the Hyperledger. So that's the
like. Thank you. Very nice questions. The thing is that due to the, let's say, short time ahead, did not have chance to go overall through them. For instance, why Hyperledger, through the slide that I tried to explain, is that initially we preferred to work with a permissioned blockchain because through this we could, let's say, give special attention to the different dynamics of blockchains that we would like. I mean, for us, even as it came from the specific use case where we have specific partners there, it would be easier to experiment with this. It is within our plans, though, as said, to go also to, let's say, more open public blockchains, starting from Quorum, which is Ethereum-based, and then try to see also how it could be evolved further. As far as it concerns, let's say, the second question, which had to do with
well, it's supposed to be only one question.
But okay.
Okay. And thank you very much, because
I will.